Thank you. Thank you, Heather. It's great to be here with all of you. You guys have a great energy, I can tell already. I was in the hotel room prepping, or supposedly I was supposed to be prepping for this talk this morning. I got lost reading all of your biographies this morning on the website, which is really neat. It looks like you all have just a tremendous amount of experience already out working in the world and a lot to offer over this next year, which is really neat. And I loved reading the little statements each of you have too. I think it just really says a lot about what matters to you and the kinds of things you're gonna do not only this year, but further in your lives. So thanks for giving me the chance to read that stuff this morning. So I'm doing the post-lunch talk, which is always a little bit difficult. So I teach a class, and we'll talk more about this, in Uganda, which is, the organization is called SOCHMED, and it's all about the social determinants of health. But we've been doing this for about 5 years. And after lunchtime, usually around 1 o'clock, is when we restart. And we're on the second floor of a building at a medical school. It's hot. This is up in Gulu in northern Uganda. And it's a really difficult time to teach. So our Ugandan students told us a few years ago, they said, you guys gotta start doing energizers. We're like, what's an energizer? It turns out that's kind of an icebreaker. I'm not gonna make everyone get up and do a big icebreaker. But I thought what we could start with, although you guys have music going already, is a song. And this is be an easy icebreaker. When you know who sings the song, and maybe why it's relevant at this time, I just want you to go ahead and raise your hand. Okay, I'm just gonna play a small segment of the song, all right? And I did, just so you know, I did this with a group of Minnesota physicians a few weeks ago I was talking about refugee and immigrant healthcare at a primary care conference, and I thought this would be like a great way to get things going. And the song's playing, no one's raising their hand. I'm like, what is going on here? It was very anticlimactic, so I'm hoping at least some of you know why we're playing this song. So I can feel good about using it. So.
When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag.
Need a dance,
and then it goes back, and then it goes back, and then it goes back. Born to a throne, stronger than Rome.
Good, I'm glad some people knew who that was. Can you believe that some people had no idea what that song was? And as I'm sure many of you know that, the reason I was playing it at the conference was, one, it was the World Cup's national song, not this year I know, but 4 years ago when the World Cup was in South Africa. Secondly, Kanan is a refugee himself. And sings a lot about that. So I thought, oh, this is like really appropriate for talking, but nobody had any idea. So thank you for knowing. The other reason I thought, oh, it'd be good to lead in with that today is actually if you are familiar with many of Kanan's lyrics, he sings very poetically about the social determinants of health in many ways, not all of his songs, but it's certainly thinking about how society experiences in life have a profound impact on one's life, and the things that might be important in responding to the social determinants of health. So that's what we're going to talk about, are the social determinants of health for the next hour and a half. And many, based on what I read this morning, I'm guessing that it's something that many of you are intimately familiar with in many ways. Maybe you haven't used those terms, or some of the terms I'll use, but you certainly have done a lot of work that involves the social determinants of health. As Heather said, my story, at least in this part of my life, is I kind of do a couple different things. One is I work as a medical anthropologist and have some training in medical anthropology, and am very interested in the impact of culture, social forces, people's backgrounds, people's stories, and how that affects who they are today. and how community plays into that. And that interest spans both the setting in which I work in St. Paul, Minnesota, and also in northern Uganda. I teach both residents in the global health pathway at the University of Minnesota, and then teach through this organization, SocMed, which I'll talk about later, and how that relates to the social determinants of health. First and foremost, though, I definitely consider myself a clinician. I work as a primary care clinician. I love doing it. I've been doing it for about 3 years at this clinic in St. Paul, which is called the Center for International Health. It's a really special clinic. It primarily serves refugee and immigrant communities in Minnesota. And it's been open for about 30 years. And during that period of time, Minnesota's just demographics have really changed a lot, where we've got large populations from all over the world, greatly to the assets of the Minneapolis and St. Paul. And on a day-to-day basis, the social determinants of health are by far most clear in the clinical work that I do. This image shows sort of what it was done a few years ago. And a group of people at the University of Wisconsin Population Health Institute said, let's really think about putting together some kind of a diagram that really explains health outcomes in any particular society or setting. And if you're a clinician practicing, looking at this is actually quite humbling because it shows you don't matter all that much. If you look at this, the things that determine health typically are health. They look at health behaviors, clinical care, and a lot of places the clinical care is actually now sort of chopped down to about 10% rather than 20. Social and economic factors, and then the physical environment. What I spend most of my time doing has a very little impact on health outcomes in society. And a lot of what does have an impact, and a huge impact, are the social determinants of health. So we're gonna talk a little bit about what those are, a little bit about the history of where people started thinking about the social determinants of health, and then take the next step and think a little bit about what is it people can do to actively engage the social determinants of health. So I ahead of time passed out a couple of more recent documents that talk about the social determinants of health. And there were two in particular. One was the WHO, probably 4 or 5 years ago, actually put together a commission of leading thinkers in the social determinants of health throughout the world. And they put together a very summative document that really says, here's the state of the social determinants of health, and here are the kinds of things we should be thinking about doing if we really want to actively engage these. And I just want to mention a couple of the statistics that are in there, because I think if we look at really setting after setting, we can see that those often at the bottom of resource or social gradients really have the highest morbidity and mortality. And again, this isn't news to any of you, I think. But oftentimes it's helpful to put it in numbers. So a couple of things that stood out to me in there, they say in this United States of America, 886,000 deaths would have been averted between 1991 and 2000 if mortality rates between whites and African Americans were equalized. This contrasts to 176,000 lives saved by medical advances at the same time. So again, you're seeing pretty big differences in terms of the impact that medical advances might make versus if we're thinking more at a social scale. Another one, of people with diabetes, 80% live in low and middle income countries. Diabetes deaths are likely to increase by more than 50% in the next 10 years without urgent action. The lifetime risk of maternal death is 1 in 8 in Afghanistan. It's 1 in 17,000 in Sweden. Then I also added in, partly because I'm a proud Minnesotan, a recent Minnesota health equity report that came out, which actually was very surprising to me. If anyone had a chance to look at it, came out, this was officially the Minnesota Department of Health, said, we've got some real you know, we've got a great, Minnesota's got a great social structure for providing care, but there are some pretty big inequities, some of the biggest inequities actually across the country are in Minnesota. So it's like, what's going on? And they actually name pretty clearly the impact of structural and institutional racism, and Minnesota is responsible for that. You do not always see that kind of language coming from the Department of Health. In there, they also talk about gross disparities in diagnosis of breast cancer between people of color and whites in Minnesota, and how people of color are diagnosed much, much later with breast cancer. Same thing, diabetes, poor diabetes care in communities of color in Minnesota. So again, kind of across various different axes. They also talk about mental health, sexual orientation, a lot of different axes in which we see big discrepancies in health. At the Center for International Health, these numbers crystallize in people every day. And I was just thinking back to last week and some of the patients that I saw and how every, you know, time and time again, there are clear social determinants of health at play. A couple of examples are, one is a woman, a 60-year-old woman from Ethiopia, who I've known for about 2 or 3 years since I've been practicing there. She's been in Minnesota for since 2004. She left because their particular ethnic group was being persecuted in Ethiopia and came as a refugee to Minnesota. Was pretty healthy when she arrived. And then settled in, started working multiple jobs to be able to pay the bills, developed diabetes, and has really quite advanced diabetes now. And when I, you know, when I ask her, and when you kind of ask her about what life is like for her, she definitely has a lot of trouble getting the right kinds of foods, even though she knows what the right kinds of foods are, because of partly the neighborhood she lives in. She lives in a neighborhood where a freeway system was built in the 1960s and really massively disrupted the neighborhood. There aren't areas for people to go out and do physical activity. You know, and I'll ask her, do you remember back in Ethiopia, what was your day-to-day life like? And she walked everywhere all the time. Here, sedentary lifestyle, not moving around, nowhere to go in the neighborhood. So lots of social factors playing into that. And I can keep giving her lots of diabetes medications and insulin and doing all those right kinds of things, but without really looking at the bigger picture, it's gonna be really hard to adequately address her diabetes. Saw another lady who is a 75-year-old lady from Myanmar or Burma, depending on sort of your politics and what the country is called. And she's been in the States for about 20 years. Pretty healthy lady, although she developed a cough in January and kept coughing. It wasn't going away. Eventually decided to get a chest x-ray, and she had in the right upper lobe of her lung, pretty big mass, which on first take looked, I mean, it looks like lung cancer and very advanced lung cancer. So I had her come in, we talked about it. She did not want to do a biopsy. She didn't want to get a sample of it done. That just felt too invasive to her. So we agreed on doing a certain test, a PET scan, which basically would help find out if this looked more like cancer or it's not so worrisome. So she agreed to go do that. A couple weeks later, I noticed I could tell it had been ordered. She went there and then it just said patient canceled appointment. And I was like, shoot, I wonder what happened. So I actually called her up and she said, you know, I want to talk about it. So she came back into clinic and we sat down. I was like, what happened? You were set up to do this test. And she said, yeah, I went into this room. There are all these machines in the room. I sat down. Two people came in. No one really introduced themselves. They put an IV into my arm, and they were about ready to leave the room. And the two of them, one was a technician, I'm guessing the other person was a radiologist, they started winking at each other. And she was sitting there, like, making these big winking, and I'm like, okay. And she said, I asked them, like, why are you winking? And they're like, don't worry about it. To her, they were winking because they were doing something to her, in her mind to her, which was possibly gonna hurt her. She had no idea what was being put into her. She's like, cancel this, I want out of here. So a really small thing but a huge impact on in terms of someone being able to get adequate, appropriate care. One other example was Friday. In clinic, we see newly arriving refugees as well, and then we have patients who have been with us for 30 years. This last Friday, I saw a family from Iraq who came in. They had been in Minnesota for about a month, and it was the dad, the mom, and then they've got three younger children. And I went in the room, and they decided they each wanted to take turns stepping out into another exam room and talking about their health. So the dad is a 43-year-old guy, big guy, really smiley guy, comes out first, and we go into the room next door. And what happens is they have a visit 2 weeks before this visit where they get a bunch of lab tests drawn, and then my job is to establish a primary care relationship and go through sort of the lab tests. And he very healthy, except I noticed he had a positive TB test, which is extremely common. He had latent TB, which is not a big deal. One out of every three people in the world have it, but it's something we want to address. And we talked about that. He was like, great, I've got access to treatment. I'll take my 9 months of INH. And then as we were wrapping up, he was like, you know, one other thing. When I've been coughing, notice the air coming out of my left ear. And I was like, oh, okay. Sounds like he probably, a lot of times people can have an infection that wasn't treated, an ear infection, and maybe he perforated his eardrum. So I was like, did you have infections when you were younger? You know, how long has this been going on? And he said, no, I never had any infections. But I did spend about 30 days in a prison in Iraq where I was tortured. And tortured by people slapping his ears repeatedly. He kind of at first shared this very matter-of-factly, and then shortly broke down and started weeping because of how hopeless he felt for his future and his family. He had been had a great job in Iraq. Things were going well in life until, for him, it was 4 years ago when they decided they needed to leave after this happened to him, and they went to Jordan. And now, all of a sudden, he's in Minnesota, completely different context, and that often is re-traumatizing in itself. But we, luckily, in our clinic, we've got great, great resources, and we have a psychotherapist who I was able to call on the spot and get into the room and start the very long process of healing from that kind of a history. 30 days in his life, profound impact in someone's health. So all these just are examples, and I'm sure many of you have lots of examples of the social determinants of health and kind of what kinds of things we're talking about when we think about it. Now, if we're gonna put this schematically, which is helpful for some people, when we think about determinants of health, there are lots of different levels. In medicine and in the training that we get in medicine, we're usually on the very inner circle. Maybe we step out to the second circle. We're really thinking about biology, microorganisms, disease processes, medications, those kinds of things. And that certainly has a role in the determinants of health. If you go out a little bit further, people start to think about behavior, and you'll hear people talk about behavioral choices people make, which sometimes has to do with the education they've had, the society within which they're living. Keep going further, we start thinking about societal and structural determinants of health. And that's kind of the realm we're thinking about in the social determinants. So societal, often your neighborhood and your community, what kinds of resources are available to you? Structural, we're thinking about some of the way society is structured along race, class, gender, sexual orientation, age, lots of different axes in which our societies are structured. And I think all of us know that that has an impact on our health. One other just schematic, again, upstream, downstream, and we're upstream thinking the bigger picture, downstream is kind of close into the body. And as I mentioned, I want just to look over at the right where it says model. So the medical model, very much objective, non-moral, non-political, you know, the kinds of things we learn in a medical school setting, really very empirical. we're thinking more upstream in a sociological social analysis model. We're thinking about things which are much more subjective. We're thinking about how people are interacting in their communities. We're thinking it's more of a moral realm. Politics play into all these things. So kind of a different way to look at it. The social determinants of health are incredibly impactful in terms of how health plays out in people and communities. And what I want to do, pause before I go any further, is because I'm sure most of you have seen these things at play, I want you to just take a moment, turn to the person next to you or the one or two people next to you and share an example of where you've seen the social determinants of health affect someone else. First, think about someone else. We'll come to ourselves in a little bit. Just a couple minutes, and we'll keep going. Lots to share, clearly. Can I, do we have any brave folks? Like, we can hear one or two examples that were shared.
So that's a good example of a sociological issue that has a much larger implications beyond a doctor talking to their patient about treatment and care for HIV. And then the medical model is more of a, well, for example, malaria. You know, you get malaria, but there's no stigma to getting malaria. And there is an easy course of treatment, it's easily prevented, and generally speaking, most people in a community where there's been some sort of outreach understand how you get malaria and how you can prevent it. And so it's not political, it's not necessarily connected to a larger political, sociological landscape. Mm-hmm. So it's simple.
Mm-hmm. Good examples of the way kind of upstream affects downstream, for sure. Let's just hear one more.
Yeah, hello. Julius, my name, from Uganda. Actually, we were sharing about the culture kind of setting, especially I'm coming from Africa, and I would really give good examples what happens really there. So I'm trying to bring into play the sense of empowerment, gender equality and empowerment of women. So you find that in the African culture, too much of power is inclined to the husband and taking decisions, especially in the family and even the health status of the entire family. So here comes, especially when it comes to family planning, sometimes men deter to listen to certain stories of, you know, we want a smaller family that is manageable, they want all this big kind of family, and you find that they cannot take care of that entire big family in the needs that they would require, especially in terms of health. Then when we look at issues of, for example, HIV testing, many people made, sometimes due to the, you know, limited kind of empowerment and the self-esteem among their women, especially men deter actually taking part in, for example, going for HIV testing. If it is women, for example, to take them for antenatal kind of care to ensure that they are giving birth to a healthy baby or to ensure that they are given that antenatal support before birth. So we are looking forward to the fact that some cultures really are being so setting us backward, especially in promoting this kind of health, you know, care. And then also, well, we are looking at instances, for example, women taking decisions in the home has been so much set down, especially in the African culture. And you find that this also affects what goes on, especially in terms of health. If, for example, a woman is like, I'm supposed to use this kind of contraceptive, he cannot or she cannot do that without the power or permission from a husband. And this is looked at as something really that puts us down, especially when it comes to promoting some of these kind of health kind of issues. Yeah, mm-hmm. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So we'll keep moving, but I'm sure there are many, many more examples. Some of the other, I heard thinking about gender, culture, lots of different levels in which we think about social determinants. I would just meant that with the example of malaria, great example. In general, I would also add, though I would caution sometimes against what sometimes seem like simple situations, maybe much more complex. And it made me think of in northern Uganda, I spent a couple of years at a clinic about 50 kilometers outside of Gulu town. and it was a clinic that was just starting to get their primary care system up and running again after the war in northern Uganda started to quiet down in 2006. And it was a really neat opportunity. I was working together with some Ugandan clinical officers and really just kind of learning about what primary care looks like there as they're trying to reinvigorate the system of delivery. One of the big issues at the time was malaria. And there was quite a bit of malaria and very high mortality due to malaria at the time there in northern Uganda. And at the time, the WHO had put together a program where they were gonna do indoor spraying on the inside of people's homes to help kill the mosquitoes. And that in itself has a debate because it partly involves chemicals and DDT and that history, which is another level of complexity. But specifically at this time, when they started coming around to people's homes to do the spraying, a lot of people were refusing initially. And the reason they were refusing initially was there was fairly deep skepticism still at the time for the central government in Uganda, just because if you look at the conflict in northern Uganda, there is some of it, not all of it, has been north-south tension. And people in the rural communities up by this clinic were worried, like, what is this? People are coming to spray on my walls. Like, is that something they're trying to harm me? They went back and did like a more extensive campaign about why they were doing this, and most people then accepted it. But it can be complicated too. Even sometimes it's very simple, but sometimes very complicated by the social cultural factors. So what I wanted to do now is briefly just talk a little bit about where the ideas of social determinants of health have come from. This is by no means exhaustive. These are important people, studies, certain things that have sort of contributed to where we're at right now in thinking about the social determinants of health, and really about what is often now thought of as the realm of social medicine. Very different than socialized medicine. I always make that point because socialized medicine can get is a whole other debate. This is social medicine. And when we're talking about social medicine, we're talking about people who think about a certain body of knowledge and practices that really incorporate these understandings that we're talking about. And it means not only understanding them, but then thinking about how do we take those understandings and put them into play in terms of how we're responding in the communities. So for a long, long time, it's been pretty obvious to humans that things other than stuff going on in the body affect health. You can go way back and find all kinds of examples. The word malaria itself comes originally from, in Roman times, malaria, bad air, and people in Rome recognizing that around the swamps, people were getting more malaria, and they thought it was something in the air that was causing it. It was more the fact that a lot of mosquitoes are breeding in that area, but people were like, there's something going on outside. More recently, there are just a couple I'm gonna mention. And again, I wanna stress this is not exhaustive by any means. And the one first person I'm gonna mention is Rudolf Virchow. And I also wanna be sensitive to the fact Maggie and I were talking before, we're in a room with a lot of white men, and Rudolf Virchow was certainly a white man too, and there are lots of people other than white men who have contributed to these understandings. Just in terms of social medicine, a lot of people go back to the mid-1800s. And Rudolf Virchow was a well-known, well-established German physician at the time. He was a pathologist. And I don't know if anyone in here has studied medicine. His name comes up all the time, Virchow's triad, this, that part of the body. He's got a big textbook that he wrote. So he's very well-respected in that realm. He was sent by the German government at the time. There was an area called Upper Silesia, which now is actually part of Poland. And he was sent there because there was an outbreak of typhus. And it was affecting the population enough that people weren't, the agriculture was falling apart, the people weren't able to pay their taxes. The central German body at that time was worried about this. So they said, Dr. Virchow, go find out what's going on. Get rid of this thing so people can be more productive. He went there. He saw what was happening. At the time, he knew it was some kind of infectious agent that was going on, but he wrote this big report in which his primary conclusion, as I wrote here, is he said, you know, the way we need to resolve this is actually through advancement of the entire population through full and unlimited democracy, education, freedom, and prosperity. Now, what was a very autocratic government structure at the time, they weren't very happy to hear this. He was saying, we need democracy and we need advancement of the population. So he was actually, he lost his medical license after publishing this. Eventually it was reinstated. But a lot of people kind of go back to that study as one of the initial, in more modern times, someone who's saying, you know what, there's more going on here than just the bacteria that's causing typhus or the rats that are carrying it or anything like that. There are more systemic things that are happening in society. Another thing, if we zip forward about 100 years, is something known as the McEwen hypothesis. And this graph really sums up what that hypothesis was. An epidemiologist by the name of Thomas McEwen took a look at mortality due to tuberculosis in England and Wales, basically between 1900 and the mid-1950s, this graph has been extended up to 2000 now. But what was clear is that mortality due to tuberculosis started to drop before anyone knew what was causing TB specifically. Before there were any, the first medication to treat TB was 1947, was streptomycin, clearly dropping before that. It was dropping before BCG immunization started. And actually, when you look at where those medical interventions happened, there wasn't really even a clear sudden decrease. It was just kind of a linear slope that's headed down. So he said, look at this. There is way more than what medicine is offering in terms of what is impacting people dying from TB and the ways that we can respond to it effectively in our community. And then in the late 70s, another kind of big piece of social determinants are something called the Whitehall Studies. And actually that WHO Commission on the Social Determinants of Health, the chair of that is a guy by the name of Michael Marmotte, and he, very early in his career, were part of these studies in England. And they were, England has in some ways, a way that society is very stratified by, almost by class for people who work in the government system. So there's the administrative class, there are all these classes and it correlates with your pay and blah, blah, blah. And so they started doing a number of studies and they were looking at not in infectious diseases anymore, looking at coronary heart disease and mortality due to it. And in the late 70s, they showed, and they continue to do this research on many, many other different diseases, but this was their first one, that mortality due to congestive heart failure amongst different age classes clearly goes up. Men, women, they've stratified this by all kinds of different ways. It clearly goes up as your social class goes down. And this has been reproduced numerous times. And they actually published a book a few years ago now called The Social Determinants of Health, which has all of this information in it. And they're doing a lot more work linking this to how lower social class or race or different things, how does that actually translate in the body into illness? And there are clear mechanisms with the actual biology. There's a very good film series that PBS put out called Unnatural Causes a number of years ago, and it's all about this kind of thing. I'd definitely recommend it if you're interested in social determinants. And this is stuff that's important in all societies throughout the world, okay? And then lastly, I just mentioned Link and Phelan. And I mention it because there's a couple of ideas in there which I think are really, really important. This was not a research study. This was more looking at sort of what social conditions are that are fundamental causes of disease. And the reason I think this is so important is they wrote this in the mid-90s. More and more in medicine, we've gotten very focused on evidence-based medicine, looking at the evidence, and often that's all medical interventions. What they started, and we've started to think about what are people's risks of disease, and what is their social history. And if you spend much time in a hospital today or back in the 90s, if we write a social history on someone, what do we usually ask about, do you think? Smoking? Okay, smoking's definitely on the list. I wish education was. It's not. Family history is part of it. What's that? Like alcohol. Yeah. So most of the time, if you go around and ask a physician or a medical student or resident the social history, they'll usually tell you whether they smoke or whether they drink alcohol. That's our social history. That's what's become the social history. This paper starts to say, you know what, those are risks for disease. Smoking and alcohol use are certainly risks for disease. But what we really need to do is ask what puts people at risk of those risks. And that is, I would say, a defining question in social medicine, is always asking why. What is putting people at risk of those particular risks? Continuing to ask why to the deeper level, okay? So, social determinants of health, so far, and what we kind of learned from what you guys have talked about and the diagrams I've shown and this history is that clearly health is a characteristic of communities, not necessarily people as much. Not that people don't matter in this at all, but one of the predominant forces are often communities. Even when people maybe make all the right choices, make the right behavior choices, it doesn't always work out for people, sometimes because of these bigger forces. And that the risk of those different behaviors really varies by context. Most lectures or discussions on the social determinants of health will often kind of end at this point. It's like we've talked about, clearly there's things in society that affect health. We've all seen them, we know them, let's put some terms on them, let's put up a couple fancy diagrams and sort of show what that looks like. And people often leave, I remember myself, either you leave feeling really overwhelmed and paralyzed because you're not sure how in the world you're ever gonna work on some of these things that are very high level societal things. Or sometimes people leave feeling really empowered and they're like, oh, I see the truth now, kind of where the problems lie, and I'm just gonna go out and tackle those social determinants of health. And for those in the latter camp, often you'll find that gets not far down the road, can get, if you're working on it on your own, it can be very demoralizing, people burn out, la-da-da-da-da. So what I wanna do with the remainder here is talk about kind of act two of the social determinants of health. What are the kinds of things we need to be thinking about? What are the skills? What are the questions we need to be asking to actively engage with the social determinants of health? And I'm gonna do that by talking about two organizations. One, I'm sure, I think some of you are going to be fellows at, I'm sure you've heard plenty about, so I'm not gonna spend much time at it, but I think it's important in the history of social medicine, which is Partners in Health. And I spent time during residency working with them. I'm sure you'll hear much more about them, so I'm not gonna belabor that, but I just think it's definitely worth mentioning. And then the other is the organization I work with, SocMed, which is really about advocating for and implementing curriculum based on the social determinants of health to give people the tools to kind of move forward, okay? As we lead into that, I wanna pause one more time. Have you guys turned to your neighbors again? And this time I want you to share how have the social determinants of health personally affected you in some setting? Think about, is there some example, some way that this, either maybe to your advantage or your disadvantage? Because I think we all, depending on our histories may have been positively or negatively influenced by the social determinants of health. So take a minute or two to do that. All right. Great. Is there anyone willing to share a little more personally about how they might have been affected by the social determinants? Yeah, I think there's probably a mic.
Oh yeah, fortunately for me, I mean, since you're the facilitator and you've been to Uganda, you probably relate a lot to what I'm going to say, but in Uganda, healthcare is supposedly free, and that's if you don't consider time to be a cost. And I've been involved a lot in monitoring health services. And I mean, by the mere fact that I have or I had a government job, it meant that you can access private care a bit more easily than the average person. But routinely you see that there's lots and lots of people waiting for free healthcare, and frustrated health workers, I mean, for one reason or the other, it's a debate for another day, but health workers are not as enthusiastic to offer the healthcare. So you can't kick off the guilty feeling that while you can get and access healthcare when you need it, these guys have to endure long lines and long hours and lose even the little economic activity they could have been engaging in during that time. And I mean, there's a loss on both sides. They think they're getting a free health service, but they're actually losing time and they're losing money because they're not working.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So you're sharing from your position, you do have access to care at times. But then also seeing the fact that a lot of people really don't have free access to care, and that raising a feeling of guilt within you. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Brooke. I've had a really interesting past few years. I went from being a full-time nurse, like a full-time professional, to being a student and then doing a fellowship with very little income. And I ended up coming back, and I'm on Medicaid right now, and I went to a clinic last week, and very different care that I received before and after. In my clinic last week, I waited 5 hours to get to see the doctor, and it was a very brash experience. I was just treated very differently than I had been before when I was a professional. Well, I still am, but when I was working full-time and I had insurance and seen very quickly and was able to get an appointment. So just seeing that in the Chicago area is pretty eye-opening. Hmm. I'm grateful for that experience.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. For those who maybe don't know, Medicaid here in the United States it's health insurance primarily if you have lower income. So usually provided via the government at the state level. Anyone else? Maybe one more?
So my name's Arielle. I'm from the Boston area, and I had an experience where right before I left, I'd gone to Planned Parenthood for some birth control care for going abroad for the year. And late Thursday night in Boston, the Supreme Court, on Thursday, but it came out kind of in the media on Thursday night. The Supreme Court made a decision to change. There's a rule for Planned Parenthood. There used to be a buffer zone where protesters couldn't cross this buffer. So it would help kind of protect young women who were, or any woman or any person who goes to Planned Parenthood instead of, you know, for protesters who are outside, that it kind of protects them from not being harassed as they walk to the door. And so I went on Friday morning, I was packing and everything, hadn't even seen the news about this decision. And I went and there were all of these news broadcasters and there were a lot of protesters, and there was a woman that followed me all the way up to the door harassing me and saying, save your child, you don't have to do this, this is the wrong decision, you can have your baby. And I wasn't even there for an abortion, but I spoke to someone in the clinic waiting room who was. And it just was so distressing because I would have kind of gone to my normal gynecologist, but I hadn't had time, and so I made this appointment at Planned Parenthood. And it was just really, it was an example of how this political decision that was made in Massachusetts impacted just this experience of all of the people that went to Planned Parenthood that day and were just verbally harassed by people who, it's okay to have a different opinion, but not to make someone feel so uncomfortable as they walk through the door of a clinic in that way, so.
Great, thanks. Yeah, so we see, we're talking about the sociological model, politics mattering for health and access to care. Great example of that. Thanks for sharing. And in many ways, this is a better transition into SocMed, but I just want to, I'll say one or two things about partners in health, and then we'll talk about SocMed and kind of the personal and what we think about. So partners in health, the reason that I mention them is it, partly because I know more intimately what they do, and I don't think they are the only organization which uses social medicine in their work. But it really, social medicine really does form a core philosophy of where Partners in Health comes from. So for those that don't know, they're an organization that works in a number of different countries. They started in the mid 80s, primarily in Haiti first, and then work also in Rwanda, Malawi, Lesotho, Mexico, Russia, and a couple other small sites. And they really, they utilize a social medicine perspective. They, as their statement says, they really think about making a preferential option for the poor. So they're in thinking a lot about health equity and recognizing again that when we're looking often at social determinants of health, it's those who have the least resources or are at the bottom of the social gradient along many different axes. Those are folks who are confronted much more with sickness, illness, death. Their model of response in any setting really uses what it looks like is they'll talk a lot about a biosocial model. And we just spent a little bit of time talking about the bio and the social, but those are really kind of the different determinants of health. So the different parts that play into who's healthy and who's not. And they think about using a biosocial model to analyze the situation and then craft responses. And most anyone within Partners in Health will talk about how if you're focused more on one or the other, you can go the wrong direction. So if you're thinking too much about the biology, which we've spent a lot of time talking about the feelings in that, you certainly can go wrong. But at the same time, if you're just thinking about the social context and culture and economics and you're not making sure that you're delivering the highest quality care to people, you also can really fall flat on your face. So at the sites in which they operate, they're working very closely, often with the local government. They have extremely well-trained clinicians who, you know, are experts in HIV, TB, chronic disease, all kinds of things, both from the United States and from the communities in which, with which they're working. But equally important at the same time at any site, they are going to have folks who are also experts in many ways on paying attention to education, jobs in the community and employment, transportation, nutrition, food access. Like those things have to go hand in hand together if you're really going to have a biosocially informed delivery program. So I think just a very good example, by no means does PIH do everything right and they're not perfect, but they certainly take very seriously a social medicine analysis and really have succeeded in many respects in actually implementing it. So, and then then SocMed. So SocMed, it really is an organization which we think a lot about implementing and advocating for the social determinants of health. And I'm sharing this because I think there's some things we've learned through our 5 years of work, which are really in synergy with the kind of work that Global Health Core is doing and the kinds of philosophies driving the work. And I actually, for us, think it's, for us, we've learned so much about how to embrace the social determinants of health, not through as much the knowledge piece, but just through some of the principles and the values. So we, what very small organization, we have a very little budget, but we were founded about 5 years ago. And it was some Ugandan colleagues and myself, my wife who's a sociologist. We were in northern Uganda at the time, and we were like, you know, no one's really adequately paying attention to the social determinants of health. No one, part of it was, while I was in med school, I didn't have adequate training in it. The Ugandan medical students at Gulu University said, this isn't really part of our training either, but it seems really important. The other part of it was, I had done this myself and then saw many other medical students from the US come and work in Gulu, not know there's a medical school there, miss lots of opportunities for partnerships and learning from other students who were in the at the same level of training as myself. And so we dreamed up a curriculum that was really gonna focus on the social determinants of health. And we've done it for 5 years. It's a 1 month class. We have half Ugandan medical and nursing students and then half students from anywhere else in the world. Most are from the US, but we've had folks from other countries as well. And then we also have a class that's offered in Haiti as well. There are three things that really drive our what our curriculum looks like. And we refer to those as the three P's. And they are praxis, the personal, and then partnership. And I think many of those are the same kinds of things you guys are being asked to think about, maybe with different terminology. But I want to just mention those three and what it means. And again, I'm sharing this because I really think it's what gets us to actively engaging the social determinants of health. So praxis really means, does anyone know what praxis is? Heard about it? Yeah. So that is part of it, I would say. So thinking about theory and then actually putting it in practice. So there's like action and being active. Anyone want to add to that? So it means that there is really, the other part of it is the reflection piece. So it's that you're constantly in this, in many ways, a circle of reflecting and acting. And the term actually originally comes from Paulo Freire, who's an educator. He wrote a book called Pedagogy of the Oppressed. But it's really, there has to be this continual process of not only using the knowledge and doing stuff, but then pulling back and thinking about it. But you can't think about it all the time and just get paralyzed. You gotta take action too. So it needs to be the two of them constantly going. And in our class, we're trying to do that. We have people spending time in the hospital wards. We have people doing community visits. People spend some time at Taso Gulu, I know you heard a lot about Taso this morning. A number of other community sites as well, but then we're always coming back to reflect. And that process really starts to spark innovative thinking. It sparks some real engagement with the community and really sparks some neat action that can happen. I wanna give you an example of our students last year put this together. And this was what they later in the class, the third or fourth week, they're asked to, you know, what are you guys gonna do about all this stuff we're learning about? We're learning about structural violence, racism, culture, all these different things. Like, what are we gonna do about this? And they put this together as an example of using a social medicine approach.
The White Campaign. An exercise of thinking deeper about what is making us sick.
Samuel is a 34-year-old male from northern Uganda who has been diagnosed with MDR-TB, multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis.
Why did he contract multi-drug-resistant TB?
Samuel was exposed to a contact with TB and delayed care because the health facility was very far from his home.
Why would he delay care?
Because being from a poverty-stricken area, he had to take time saving money for transport to the health facility. When he finally arrived, there was a long line of patients.
Why?
Why is there such poor delivery of care at the hospital?
With few staff and no drugs, this hospital is largely representative of a national public health facility. The healthcare providers have poor pay and little training.
Why?
Why is the healthcare underfunded by Uganda's government?
The policies of the Ugandan government emphasize the productive sectors over the consumptive sectors, in which health and education fall. This cuts down on healthcare workers, drugs, and causes poor payment of healthcare providers.
Why
would the Ugandan government prioritize the productive over consumptive sector?
Uganda, just like many developing countries, has agreed to harsh loans with organizations such as the World Bank and International Monetary Fund. In these agreements, Uganda has to pay high interest rates and agree to emphasize policies that encourage foreign investments such as privatization, liberalization, debt reduction, and currency devaluation, effectively creating a macro economy that forgets the cries of our people. Health for wealth.
Why do we ask why?
So an example of the action that can come out, and not only the action in putting this together, but the students then took it. We have a Ugandan member of parliament who is a physician, comes in and knows a lot about economics and health economics, and is actually in parliament now. And they shared this with him, and then he shared it with some of his colleagues. So again, trying to take some action based on the reflection they've had in class. So that's praxis, the praxis piece. The personal is a couple of things. One is when we talk about the social determinants of health, we often are talking about things that feel like either they're very academic or they're out there, kind of structural violence, racism, gender inequality. And it can be easy for us to forget that we're all part of those things too. And we have, in SocMed, we think it's really critical for people to start to think about the ways in which they're connected to those things. You guys are I was really excited when I looked at the 10-day training you have and to see how much involvement you have with Still Harbor. I know, and this happens in our classes too, sometimes when we start to do this kind of stuff, it sometimes can be uncomfortable. Sometimes people are like, oh, this is like soft stuff, like I don't want to talk about this and how I'm involved. But it actually is the part that can be transformational. So just looking at the training curriculum, you guys are really lucky to have that built in on a daily basis. And in our class, we do a number of different activities throughout, which are asking people to be in touch with those types of things. And go back to the PowerPoint. One of the things we do, I'm bringing this up, skipping to the partnership piece, but one of the things we do in class is we do something called the privilege walk. Some of you may have done this before. It's an activity that's done in silence. And we have half the group lines up in the middle of the room. And then a series of statements are read. And those statements are things that may tease out differences in people's backgrounds and privilege. Did your parents go to college? Have you ever been a victim of violence? And people are asked to either step forward or backwards based on those statements. At the end, you turn and you look around and you see where people are kind of standing in the room. And it provokes a very visceral reaction for people. We usually have an hour or two of debriefing at the end. And people learn, we don't do it right away because it starts to happen after people start to build relationships. And these two folks, this is actually our first year that we did our class, and this is Connie on the left and Pamela on the right. And the two of them were partner pairs, so we do kind of a partner pairing in the same way that you guys have a co-fellow. And 3 weeks into the class, their relationship had really developed. They started to really get to know each other. Pamela is from northern Uganda. Connie was from outside of Baltimore, I think, originally. Had very different experiences in life, but really had started to form a really solid relationship. In the privilege walk, Connie ended up at the front of the room and Pamela was at the very, very end of the room. And that was extremely difficult for them to suddenly see after they had been building this relationship. What it did, though, was it catalyzed the conversation between them, which they always still refer back to now, about how understanding their own social position and the strengths and limitations that come with that, sometimes the guilt that comes with being up at the front, sometimes the real sadness of being at the back of the room and like, oh, wow, this feels horrible. What understanding that did catalyze a conversation for them, which they've been able to really build off of, both for their relationship, but then also for the work that they're doing in their lives, because they know themselves and where they're coming from a bit better. I was recently listening to, if anyone knows On Being, is a national public radio program here. It's done once a week in the US, and it's kind of spirituality, religion, science, a lot of different things. And there was a couple weeks ago, there's a guy by the name of Jonathan Haidt, who is a social psychologist. I had never heard him before, never heard of him before. But what he was talking about was the psychology of morality and morals that people have. And he has spent a lot of time here in the United States looking at people who come from very different political persuasions and backgrounds and finding out like what is it that keeps people from having conversations and polarizes people, and what is it that kind of brings people together. And one of the things he said in it is, he said, debating and presenting all the facts, doing that with some, you can do that ad nauseum, and it often will never change anyone's mind or convince anyone of anything. But what you do is you get people who you want to start having conversations, building relationships. And time again, that's where people start to really learn from each other, build, grow, and develop. And so that, for us, related to the social determinants of health and all these difficult, sticky issues which are hard to talk about, has been really, really transformational. And I think it will be for you as well during this year in the way that your fellowship is set up. And finally, the big piece about the personal too is what it does is it brings about real partnership. And a lot of people talk about the importance of partnership in global health work, and it's actually really hard to do. If you're gonna do partnership well, it's much harder than just saying we're partners and this is a great partnership. It's gritty, it's messy, it's hard, especially when you might come from different persuasions or backgrounds. But letting yourself open up into that personal starts to build that partnership piece. Connie and for Connie and Pamela it has, and they've continued to work on different health projects from overseas together, and lots of our other students have as well, just in thinking about that partnership piece. Full circle to the social determinants, the reason partnership is so incredibly important is I don't think I've ever seen an example of anyone really effectively making change in the social determinants of health on their own. You don't do it alone. You do it together in communities and groups of people. Sometimes you're like-minded, sometimes you're not. But it's needing to join together and see your strengths and weaknesses and be able to actively engage the social determinants of health. And that's part of what you're all starting to do now and will do over the next year, is building that community of partnerships to work on this kind of stuff. When we talk about the practice of social medicine now, and what that actually means. It can mean lots of different things for people based on their interests. We talk about participation in social movements, activism. That might be your thing. There's space for people to do that in communities. We think about, some people really like to do research. We think about participatory action research, which is research in a particular community with the community to bring about change. Some people really are interested in education, and education for SocMed and for our students, what that means is using some of this critical thinking, asking the questions, why the risks of the, or what are the risks of the risks, and really asking people to dig deeper. Some people want to practice clinical medicine, and a lot of the training is about how do you start to listen to patients' stories and those social determinants of health and kind of bear witness to that and then take action based on that. And then sometimes people want to work out in communities, do public health work, and just work on building effective partnerships. So actually, taking action can be lots and lots of different things based on who you are, what you're interested in, and what that community might need in particular. Final closing quote, which I think sums up much of what I'm talking about. This is actually, so Paul Farmer was one of the founders of Partners in Health. This is actually from an afterword of a book, which was, that Paul didn't write, that a young primary care physician working in Los Angeles wrote. Rishi Manchada is his name, and the name of the book is The Upstream Doctors. And it, the book is about getting people to think, and clinicians in particular, more about the upstream. And I just thought this really nicely summarizes the kinds of things we need to be thinking about. So at the end of almost a decade spent in teaching hospitals and clinics, most physicians have honed their clinical acumen by focusing on the care of the patient who is right in front of them. Perhaps this is as it should be. As patients, we don't want our doctors distracted by outside considerations, such as the concerns of patients in other exam rooms, or heaven forfend, by abstractions such as the extrapersonal social forces that place people in harm's way. We want laser-like focus, to use a term from the medical profession, on our own chief complaint. Just for some of you that who may or may not know Paul can be sarcastic, so that there is some sarcasm in the end of that statement there. And he goes on to say, or do we? What if most of our aches and pains and many of our serious ailments come largely from those outside forces and abstractions? What if we acknowledge that we live not only in bodies, but also in families, homes, most of us, neighborhoods, and cities? What if our lives outside of the clinic or hospital are often difficult or even, for some people, at some times almost unendurable? What if our clinical diagnosis is not our chief complaint? So I will end there. Thank you guys very much for your listening and participation.